The purpose of the Church Handbook is to provide guidance on church administration to millions of church leaders and members throughout the world. It always has been a living, breathing, changeable document.
So it's going to change over time, and it just gives us a framework to be able to move forward in our work.
As new inspiration or revelation comes, the handbook can be updated to meet the conditions of the children of God.
The handbook is written in a manner that each person can feel God's love. As followers of Jesus Christ, that's what we want. We want to have every single person feel that they are included, that they're welcome, that they're loved. They feel part of the Lord's church.
We updated all of the moral policies in February of 2020. However, we just added one new policy on prejudice. This is based on recent teachings of the First Presidency about the evils of prejudice, and the handbook allows all of our church leaders and members to be aware of that instruction. The policy draws on their prophetic teachings and ancient scripture, and it's rather strong. I'll quote part of it. The church calls on all people to abandon attitudes and actions of prejudice toward any group or individual, close quote. Our February 2020 release of the handbook was very clear and strengthened about sexual abuse. We've made a couple of small changes in this release to clarify that sexual abuse is not only about children and youth. It can happen in a dating relationship, and it can happen in a marriage. We're also clear that members can report, should report, to civil authorities as well as talk to their bishop when they become aware of an abuse situation. One of the chapters that has had a complete rewrite is providing for temporal needs and self-reliance. We think that this chapter will be a blessing not only to church leaders, but also to members.
Providing for temporal needs and building self-reliance has always been an important part of God's work. I think what's new in this version of the handbook is that it's written in a ministerial voice, and it's written in a very inclusive way. We're not talking about just caring for the poor and needy, if you will. We all have needs. And so it's helping each of us as individuals increase our self-reliance and also improve our physical and spiritual well-being. What you'll find in this new handbook version is that it's more about principles rather than practices, and more about ministering rather than administering a program. Traditionally, we tend to look at that as being the bishop's responsibility, and that he has, of course, an important responsibility to seek out those who are in need. But in terms of ministering to those, that's everyone's work. We've been putting a lot of emphasis in this section on the role of the women's organization, what we call the Relief Society, and the men's organization, or what we call the Elders' Quorum, but also each of us in our responsibilities as we minister one to another. I think what's also new in this section is that it recognized the important role that youth can play.
One additional aspect of this chapter is that temporal needs include emotional needs, and counseling resources and emotional self-reliance tools are available for our leaders and our members.
Some of the major updates to the temple sections in the handbook really describe how important the temple is to us. The temple is the house of the Lord. Everything in the temple points to Jesus Christ. And as we receive certain sacred acts or sacraments that we call ordinances, it binds us and our families to Heavenly Father. Some of the specific changes in the handbook describe the endowment, which is really a gift from our Heavenly Father, and the endowment in the temple is really the culmination of all of these promises that we make in the temple. One of the specific additions in this handbook is entitled, When to Receive the Endowment. It's really an individual's own choice. Local leaders should not use specific criteria such as reaching a certain age or leaving home to serve in the military or for a job. When they're trying to decide when to go to the temple, it's really an individual choice. Families and other members can talk about the purpose and the doctrine of the covenants that we enter into in the temple. And that's why, for the first time, these are included in the handbook. Another purpose is to help leaders and family members help others as they go to the temple for the first time to understand the covenants that they enter into. The primary responsibility falls upon the parents to help their children understand these covenants before they go to the temple. Some of the changes also include discussing how local leaders, which we refer to as Elder's Quorum presidencies and the sisters in the Relief Society presidencies, describe their importance in leading this temple and family history work locally in each individual congregation. Our local leaders are important to this because they can help individual members learn how to discover their individual ancestry names and then go to the temple and receive those ordinances in the temple on behalf of their ancestors.
Councils are one of the most important ways that we function in the church, from family councils through stake and ward councils to the general level of councils. The updated handbook gives us some wonderful material on updating how we're going to meet and how often and who's going to be there, just so that it helps us to really refine how we work together as church leaders.
22 of the 38 chapters have now been updated. The remaining 16 chapters will be updated during 2021. In addition, the translation of the handbook is underway in 35 languages. 14 of those chapters were released in December in many, many languages.
Rewriting the handbook has been quite a process. A lot of people have put their best thinking into it, and there have been quite a few people who have reviewed what goes in the handbook so that it actually meets the needs of members throughout the world.
When the members of the 70 and the general officers feel that the chapters are as good as we can make them, they're submitted to the Quorum of the 12 Apostles. The apostles come back with their edits and changes. Those are incorporated. And finally, the First Presidency has the final say and final review.
One of the things I like about the new general handbook is that it is available to the public. It is open to anyone who wants to read it, leaders, members, nothing is hidden. The church honors personal agency and personal revelation. We have a responsibility to know for ourselves, and the handbook does not take that away from us. Each one of us has a responsibility to look for and receive the personal revelation we need in our callings and in our personal lives, and I love that about the handbook.